Do black holes exist? Well, I'm going to introduce you to an article that opens up a controversy about whether black holes actually exist. There's an article in phys.org which is entitled "Researcher Shows That Black Holes Do Not Exist." And it's September 24. And it can be found on the internet, so you don't have to trust me. You can look it up for yourself. The article starts, "Black holes have long captured the public imagination and have been the subject of popular culture from Star Trek to Hollywood." I didn't know there was a difference there. But they're the ultimate unknown, the blackest and most dense objects in the universe that do not even let light escape. And as if they weren't bizarre enough to begin with, now add this to the mix. They don't exist. By merging two seemingly conflicting theories, Laura Mersini-Houton, a physics professor at UNC Chapel Hill in the College of Arts and Sciences, has proven mathematically that black holes can never come into being in the first place. The work not only forces scientists to reimagine the fabric of space-time, but also to rethink the origins of the universe. The articles, by the way, don't mention a thing about the origins of the universe, but whatever. For decades, black holes were thought to form when a massive star collapses under its own gravity to a single point in space. Imagine the Earth being squished into a ball the size of a peanut. Or smaller, called a singularity. So the story went, an invisible membrane known as the event horizon surrounds the singularity, and crossing this horizon means that you could never cross back. It's the point where a black hole's gravitational pull is so strong that nothing can escape it. The reason black holes are so bizarre is that it pits two fundamental theories of the universe against each other. Einstein's theory of gravity predicts the formation of black holes, but a fundamental law of quantum theory says that no information from the universe can ever disappear. Efforts to combine these two theories lead to mathematical nonsense and became known as the information loss paradox. Now, nobody really disagrees with that statement that I've been able to read. In 1974, Stephen Hawking used quantum mechanics to show that black holes emit radiation. Since then, scientists have detected fingerprints in the cosmos that are consistent with this radiation. Interesting. Identifying an ever-increasing list of the universe's black holes. But now, Mersini-Houton describes an entirely new scenario. She and Hawking both agree that as a star collapses under its own gravity, it produces Hawking radiation. However, in her new work, Mersini-Houton shows that by giving off this radiation, the star also sheds mass. So much so that as it shrinks, it no longer has the density to become a black hole. So it becomes an almost black hole and then stops. Before a black hole can form, the dying star swells one last time and then explodes. A singularity never forms, and neither does an event horizon. The take-home message of her work is clear. There is no such thing as a black hole. The paper, which was recently submitted to Archive, an online repository of physics papers that is not peer-reviewed, so it's not in the peer-reviewed literature, so it doesn't count, offers exact numerical solutions to this problem and was done in collaboration with Harold Pfeiffer, an expert on numerical relativity at the University of Toronto. An earlier paper by Mersini-Houton, originally submitted to Archive in June, was published in the journal Physics Letters B, so that one is true, and offers approximate solutions to the problem. Experimental evidence may one day provide physical proof as to whether or not black holes exist in the universe, but for now, Mersini-Houton says, the mathematics are conclusive. Well, the mathematics are conclusive, period, if you accept the assumptions. I think that's the point. Question is, are the assumptions any good? Many physicists and astronomers believe that our universe originated from a singularity that began expanding with the Big Bang. However, singularities do not exist, and physicists have to rethink their ideas of the Big Bang and whether it ever happened. Whoa, okay. And if not, what goes in its place? Physicists have been trying to merge these two theories, Einstein's theory of gravity and quantum mechanics, for decades. Both of them very, very well attested theories, predicting very strange stuff that have proven to be true. But this scenario brings these two theories together into harmony, said Mersini-Houton, and that's a big deal. And, you know, they have the references behind it now. Notice the very end provided by University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, which is, of course, where Mersini-Houton works. Now, what about this? That sounds kind of like they took it for granted, right? Okay. But since it's provided by her university, of course the university is going to agree with her. Well, not necessarily. The university doesn't agree with Behe, but, you know. So this is kind of propaganda. Take it with a grain of salt. Well, what about those references? Mersini-Houton in 2014. Black holes ? And you can look this up. And, in fact, the abstract is available. But the paper is available at archive.org. Interestingly enough, online it's not available at Physics Letters without some money. So I assume that the archive.org paper is not that much different from the final published paper. And we'll be looking at what we can, and not too hard, as you will see why in just a minute. Okay, the abstract of that paper starts, particle creation leading to Hawking radiation is produced by the changing gravitational field of the collapsing star. The two main initial conditions in the far past placed on the quantum field from which particles arise are the Hartle-Hawking vacuum and the Unruh vacuum. And they're going to do the Unruh vacuum next, and I'm not sure that I can explain easily the difference between the two. The former leads to a time-symmetric thermal bath of radiation, while the latter leads to a flux of radiation coming out of the collapsing star, which sounds somewhat similar to each other. The energy of Hawking radiation in the interior of the collapsing star is negative and equal in magnitude to its value at future infinity. Radiation that's going into the star is negative. Well, what's negative? I guess that means that it has negative mass or something. Well, this work investigates the back reaction of Hawking radiation on the interior of a gravitationally collapsing star in the Hartle-Hawking initial vacuum. It shows that due to the negative energy Hawking radiation in the interior, the collapse of the star stops at a finite radius before the singularity and the event horizon of a black hole have a chance to form. That is, the star bounces instead of collapsing to a black hole. A trapped surface near the last stage of the star's collapse to its minimum size may exist and still exist temporarily, or a effectively trapped. In other words, it's not completely. It will take many times the universe's age, supposedly, to evaporate the star, and so it's not really trapped, but it is close to trapped. Its formation depends on the details of collapse. Results for the case of Hawking flux of radiation with the Unruh initial state will be given in a companion paper, too, which we'll look at next. I'm going to read a few things that will make sense, and then you'll see why I skipped the rest of it. The back reaction of Hawking radiation onto a star collapsing into a black hole is a long-standing problem of major importance. It carries a tantalizing possibility that black holes may not form at all. Hawking radiation arises as particle creation from curved space-time quantum field theory. As I understand it, the way it happens is that right near the edge of the black hole, virtual particles pop in and out of existence. If one of the particles goes far enough to go into the black hole, it gets absorbed there, and the other particle is going the opposite direction. And so tries to escape, and does eventually escape after losing most of its mass. The particle that goes in actually decreases the mass of the black hole. Quantum mechanics, I don't pretend to know exactly how that happens. So this actually is created when you have that kind of space-time curvature. Therefore, if its back reaction on the star's dynamics is significant, it would provide an example of the crucial role quantum effects play on strong gravitational fields, such as those of massive imploding stars. Now, in 1939, Oppenheimer and Snyder found that the ultimate fate of a spherically symmetric collapsing star is to collapse to a black hole. Well, that was easy. A big enough star, it should just kind of go, and once it gets past the limit, there's nothing to stop it keeping it from collapsing. In fact, there's no way it cannot collapse. And the star should just kind of wink out, right? In 1974 and 1975, Hawking, then Parker, found that quantum effects from the curved space-time produced by the strong gravitational field of a star collapsing into a black hole give rise to a thermal flux of particle production known as Hawking radiation. Despite the efforts devoted to understanding the physics of black holes since Hawking's discovery of radiation, the main stumbling block in these efforts has been the issue of information loss paradox, stated in various forms. One of the most spectacular paradoxes stemming from the information loss mystery is a recent firewall problem raised in reference 5, then followed by the forecasting of reference 6. So this Hawking radiation should produce this radiant energy that's going out in all directions from the black hole. It can't get very far because as it tries to get out, it has to climb out of the gravitational well and loses most of its energy. And so energy that was originally X-rays or gamma rays or a cosmic ray variety will actually slowly decrease until they're infrared or maybe microwave or below. Amidst all the puzzles and paradoxes, a trivial possibility is that black holes may not form. This possibility is the focus of the current study. Within a set of approximations such as assumptions of spherical symmetry and homogeneity of a star collapsing into a black hole, so this is phase one, we're going to assume that the star is all the same all the way around as it's collapsing. This work shows that a black hole may not form when the back reaction of the quantum flux of particles created is taken into account in the collapse dynamics of the star. And here's the next part of the paper, and I think you can see why we're not going to drag you through this. I mean, what is that supposed to mean? That's some very special, and it's not just standard algebra. Some of those things have different rules. And there's, you know, equation 1, equation 2, equation 3, and they're skipping a whole bunch of steps because they're physicists and they understand how you get from one to the other. I will have to confess, I don't follow that very well. But we'll move on to the conclusions. This, remember, passed peer review, so some physicists did understand it or thought they did and thought it was okay. We considered a spherically symmetric time-dependent star undergoing gravitational collapse into a black hole. Including the back reaction of negative energy Hawking radiation in the interior of the star leads to a behavior whereby the star collapses to a minimum radius, then bounces before a black hole event horizon or singularity have a chance to form. Despite that, temporarily trapped surfaces may form for photons located in the interior of the star during the interval of collapse near its minimum size stage, but not beyond this stage. During the stage that a temporarily trapped surface exists around the star would appear the same as a black hole would to an external observer. So maybe we should call them dark holes. Since information about the star is temporarily hidden behind the trapped surface, well, that's making the assumption that the star is spherically symmetrical, and that may not necessarily be the case. For one thing, the star may have rotatory motion. But in her second paper, which I don't know where it is in terms of peer review at this point, I haven't seen it published yet, officially in the peer-reviewed literature, but it is an archive. Back reaction of the Hawking radiation flux in Unruh's vacuum on a gravitationally collapsing star, she's going to generalize. Again, this is available on the internet. Introduction, the back reaction of Hawking radiation on the evolution of the collapsing star is the most important problem in the quantum physics of black holes. This problem provides an arena for the interplay of quantum and gravitational effects on black holes and their respective implications for the singularity theorem. How do you make both theories be correct? Or are we going to have to discard one theory? A key feature of Hawking radiation, which is well established in seminal works by various authors, is that radiation is produced during the collapse of the star prior to black hole formation. In other words, you don't have to wait until the black hole actually happens before you start getting Hawking radiation. All you have to do is get close enough, which makes sense because the Hawking radiation actually takes place just before the black hole margin itself. And therefore, it could happen just before you form the black hole itself. The very last photon making it to future infinity and thus contributing to Hawking radiation is produced just before a horizon forms. Well, maybe not. Some of the black hole theory says that it actually happens when you get to, after the black hole forms as well. But the effect of Hawking radiation on the collapse evolution of the star was for the first time considered in reference one, which is her previous one that we just read the abstract of and the conclusion and so forth. In one, it was shown that once the back reaction of Hawking radiation is included in the interior dynamics of the star, then the star collapse stops and the star bounces. Solving analytically for the combined system of a collapsing star with Hawking radiation included is quite a challenge. The system studied in one was idealized in order to obtain an approximate analytical solution. There, the star was taken to be homogeneous. The star's fluid considered was dust. The star was placed in a thermal bath of Hawking radiation, which arises from the time-symmetric Hartle-Hawking initial conditions on the quantum field in the far past. Within these approximations, the main finding of one was that a singularity and a horizon do not form because the star reverses its collapse and bounces at a finite radius due to the balancing pressure of the negative energy Hawking radiation in its interior. Yet, the evolution of the star could not be followed beyond the bounce with the approximate analytic methods of one. Given the fundamental importance of this problem and the intriguing results of her previous work, we here aim to study the background of Hawking radiation on a collapsing star by considering a more realistic setting. Namely, we allow the star to be inhomogeneous. Some parts are denser than others. And based on pair creation near the surface, we consider an Hawking radiation flux of negative energy, which propagates in the interior of the star with its counterpart of positive energy flux traveling from near the surface outward to infinity. And so they're going to allow stars that are not perfectly symmetrical. And math still works. Skipping on for most of that, for the model presented here, we have shown that due to the back reaction of radiation onto the star does not form a singularity or an apparent horizon. Therefore, neither unitary nor causality, nor causality are violated. That is, you don't have to violate, in this particular case, either general relativity or or quantum mechanics. Our findings offer a solution to the long-standing information loss paradox. Interestingly here, universally these stars shine with Planck luminosity independent of their mass on their last stage of collapse as they approach the horizon, and decelerate and reverse the collapse before crossing the horizon. Or maybe we should say instead of crossing the horizon. Due to huge time dilatation effects, the evaporation of these objects from far away would seem so slow that in fact these stars would not look much different from a black hole to a faraway observer. In fact, there's a major difference between them and the black holes. Unlike the classical black holes, these quantum stars do not contain singularities. So they're almost black holes. They're really dark holes. Okay. Well, of course, there are others who commented, and I've selected one of the what I would consider the better ones. The article is on a blog site, it's a blog of a commercial blog, kind of, arstechnica.com/science. Completely implausible. A controversial paper exists, but so do black holes. A researcher stands by her arguments against black holes. Other scientists are skeptical. That's the subtitle. So here's the argument on the other side. And it's, I have no clue as to who Zach Zetelny is, but whatever. There was once a time when the existence of black holes was very much in doubt. Even Albert Einstein was an early doubter. So apparently doubting this is not that bad of an idea, doubting that black holes form. Despite the fact that black holes were predicted by using his equations of general relativity, he simply believed nature wouldn't permit them. At best, Einstein thought black holes might be theoretically possible, but they weren't the sort of thing that would or even could be observed. Of course not. Although what they did to other things might be observed. Today, that era is long past. Black holes remain theoretical for some time, but they have become a standard feature of astrophysics, a practical reality. While some physical details of black holes are still very much in question, currently a strong scientific consensus exists that black holes are real and that new black holes are regularly discovered. Notice that word, consensus. Where have we heard that before? In the light of that, things have gotten peculiar recently. Headlines all over the internet have declared that black holes don't exist after all. See, for example, there are no such thing as black holes. And some argue their lack of existence has been mathematically proven. Well, if you accept the principles involved. The headlines are reporting on a recent paper submitted to Archive, which has not, as of this writing, emerged from peer review, although it builds on the author's earlier work, which has. So the math is fundamentally okay. The paper's primary author, Laura Mersini-Houton, a theoretical physicist at University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, claims that her work proves that black holes cannot form in the first place. I'm still not over the shock, she said in a written statement issued by the university. We've been studying this problem for more than 50 years, and this solution gives us a lot to think about. Mersini-Houton is not the first one to claim that black holes don't exist. Stephen Jay Crothers has been claiming to have disproven their existence for quite some time, and even Stephen Hawking has issued a statement that there are no black holes, although he didn't mean that literally. Although maybe he did, and he realizes that very dark holes are practically black holes. I don't know. Mersini-Houton's claims are even more extraordinary, however. And we all know what extraordinary claims require. Where is that used before? You have to have extremely good evidence that black holes don't exist before you can't believe in them. That sounds like slanting the argument considerably, but I digress. In order to include that black holes don't exist, she claims to have united general relativity with quantum mechanics, a feat which has been sort of a holy grail of modern physics. That should be a good thing, right? A unifying theory of this sort has thus far proved elusive despite the best efforts of the physics community. So, if Mersini-Houton's work is correct, much of physics and astrophysics might need to be rethought. Has that ever happened in physics before? Seems like 1905 a lot of physics was rethought. Is this time to consign black holes to the dustbin of scientific history along with the luminiferous ether and the geocentric model of the universe? The too long didn't read version. No, it isn't. I know. It's a weird abbreviation. I had to look it up. But it does seem like time to explore what we know about black holes and to outline how we know they exist. To that end, we spoke to some physicists with expertise in the relevant areas on both theoretical and observational side of things. Some of them took a look at Mersini-Houton's paper and were happy to respond. And right next to that is this photo of a black hole. Well, it's actually not a photo. It's an artist's rendition. An event horizon, accretion disk, and jets, all standard features of what we've thought, I think that's supposed to be, were black holes. Thinking about that, why would you do this without having some evidence to back it up? Is this the use of hypotheticals to sort of solidify the idea that they exist? Have we seen that before? These and other physicists have already discussed the issues elsewhere on the internet, including on their blogs in some cases, raising objections to the work or defending the observational evidence for black holes. We'll take you through some of their counterarguments to see why, in the minds of these physicists at least, the case is pretty strong that black holes do exist. Well, pretty strong doesn't sound like proof, does it? But you see, the other side needs extraordinary evidence. All we need is kind of something that will help us to believe. Where have we seen that kind of thing before? But first, we need to understand the reason black holes supposedly don't exist, and I'm going to skip over that because we've been through some of that already. Observational evidence. Yes, Virginia, there are black holes. Anybody know where that came from? I believe that's from, yes, Virginia, there is a Santa Claus. Boy, that's not very comforting, is it? As a matter of fact, if you go to the other blog and you read that I'm going to introduce, and you read down the comments, the guy who wrote it actually comments that that's where he got it from. Yes, Virginia, there is a Santa Claus. Mersini-Houton's work, even if accurate, leaves a massive gaping question. If black holes really don't exist, if they're impossible, then what exactly have we been looking at this whole time? Black hole skeptics might be quick to point out that black holes cannot be observed directly due to their very definition. Black holes don't reflect any light, they certainly don't emit any, and any Hawking radiation would be far too weak to be observed, so we can't observe them. So there's no way for us to directly observe a black hole. Well, let me ask you a question. Is there any way to observe a very dark hole if it also puts out very weak Hawking radiation? Doesn't sound like it, does it? So how in the world are you going to tell the difference between those two? Yes, black holes are observed, Jeffrey McClintock, an astrophysicist with Harvard University. So, you know, he must know what he's talking about. He's from Harvard. told ours, but not in the way, for example, that a planet, the sun, or neutron star has observed all objects with material surfaces. There is no surface at all in the event horizon, and anything found there is falling inward relative to a local observer at the speed of light. Moreover, according to general relativity, the event horizon is a surface of infinite redshift, which means that distant observers like us cannot hope to see any radiation, excluding ultra-feeble and unobservable Hawking radiation coming from the event horizon. So, no, you can't see it. Well, except for that feeble Hawking radiation. Wouldn't that work with an almost black hole? That much is true, although some recent work suggests Hawking radiation might be amplified by the black hole enough to be observable. Oh. Well, is it observable or not? Well, do we know? How could we tell? But despite the difficulty of direct observation, the indirect observational evidence is not ambiguous. Oh, there's no question. We're looking at something, and if it's not black holes, it sure looks a lot like them. Well, isn't that what she proposed? That there are very dark holes? For one thing, black holes are rarely observed in isolation. They tend to have matter falling in or accreting onto the black hole, often from a companion star. This matter forms an accretion disk. For what it's worth, the photo behind is actually, of course, an artist conception, a government artist conception for what it's worth. That's why I could use it without worrying. Of what it looks like. An accretion disk and the disk are very much observable. As it falls, matter speeds up, much like an unfortunate boat caught in a whirlpool, swirling down faster and faster as it gets close to the bottom. The swiftly moving matter creates quite a bit of friction, which creates heat and intense X-ray light, which our telescopes can easily detect. The black hole's effect on the motion of their companions is also observable. They and their companions co-orbit. But how do we know that the objects we're seeing are really black holes? According to McClintock, the answer is twofold. The strongest evidence that the compact objects I study are black holes is, one, dynamical evidence, that is, based on Newton's laws, that the masses of these objects exceed three sun masses, at which point a neutron star isn't big enough to escape becoming a black hole. And two, that any compact object, that is, a neutron star this massive will collapse to a black hole according to general relativity. We and others have measured the masses of about 24 compact stars with typical values of 10 sun masses. Okay. In other words, the motions of other objects near the black hole can be observed, such as the black hole's accretion disk, material, or a star co-orbiting the black hole. Based on velocities of these objects, the black hole's mass can be determined, and once scientists know the object's mass and its size, they can determine, using general relativity, whether it's compact enough to be a black hole. Because again, you can't have a neutron star bigger than three sun masses without turning into a black hole. It's pretty hard to argue that any step in this process is wrong. You step one, step two, step three, well, you got to be there. Our understanding of dynamic motions of celestial bodies is incredibly powerful. It's been honed by studying our own solar system, where it consistently predicts the motions of the planets and moons and their complex interactions with each other as they orbit the sun. This sounds like somebody defending Newtonian gravity before 1905, doesn't it? And we've even discovered Neptune, because of Newtonian gravitation. It works just as effectively everywhere else in the universe. Well, that's what we assume anyway. And it's probably a reasonable first assumption. And general relativity is also rock solid as theories go. Well, general relativity replaced Newtonian physics, which was rock solid as theories go. A huge body of evidence confirms its predictions. If general relativity were wrong, GPS systems would constantly get out of sync with their satellites, and they don't. If Newtonian physics were wrong, planets would constantly get out of orbit, but they don't. Maybe some theories are workable at some scales and not at others, or something like that. And maybe when you get close to a black hole, things change. Another astrophysicist, Brian Koeberlein, who, by the way, is, as far as I can tell, has got his PhD. He's a professor at a university. I looked it up once. I've forgotten which one. Responding to the recent headlines about Mersini-Houton's paper, summarizes the observations in his blog. So this is really peer-reviewed literature. Black holes absolutely exist. We know this observationally. We know by the orbits of the stars in the center of our galaxy that there is a supermassive black hole in its center. We know of binary black hole systems. We found the infrared signatures of more than a million black holes. We know of stellar mass black holes and intermediate mass black holes. We can even see a gas cloud ripped apart by the intense gravity of a black hole. And we can take images of black holes such as the one above. Yes, Virginia, there are black holes. Again, you can't see them. You don't know what they really look like. All those artist paintings are artist paintings. And remember, the difference between a black hole and a very dark hole is quite subtle. Given that such strong observational evidence exists for black holes, really? What can be made of Mersini-Houton's work? Even if her methodology has no flaws, how might it be reconciled with those observations? Part of the problem is that the authors do not address this issue in their paper. So they don't answer all the questions, and so therefore they must be wrong. Another way you can slant the table. It would have been very helpful if the authors had spelled out how they view the many detailed observations that have been made of dozens of stellar mass black holes, said McClintock. Are the authors really attempting to refute the existence of these compact stellar remnants? What did they say to observations that clearly show 100,000 times the power of the sun being emitted in X-ray radiation from a region around a stellar mass black hole the size of New York City? We've been there and we've seen it. Don't get too close. Likewise, how do they view other astounding phenomena observed for black holes, both stellar mass and supermassive? Be nice if they said astounding. Do you see this? Mountains of evidence. Well, the star orbits something, and the star must be this big, and something else must be that big, and therefore black holes exist. Yes, Gilbert. Keep talking, it'll come back up.
Sounds a little bit like schizophrenia.
Well, it's like I say, this is sounding more like true believers than people who are trying to look at things objectively and ask, well, maybe you're right. See, it's not maybe you're right, but here's some problems with it. It's more like, well, you can't be right because it would destroy our whole theory. Responding to this, Mersini-Houton told ours that these observed objects are the same massive objects we thought before, except that they do not have an event horizon and a singularity in the center. We have to find a suitable name for black holes without horizons and singularities. Obviously, they won't be black, at least not completely black. Given that perspective, it's not clear whether these objects can be experimentally differentiated from true black holes. If some future observation can show these objects really aren't black, whatever that would look like, Mersini-Houton's work would be vindicated. Well, when you put it that way, it doesn't sound quite so certain, does it? We sent her a follow-up question asking if any such observation is possible, and I haven't received a reply as of this writing. So, Theoretical evaluations. This model is incorrect. If observational evidence shows that black holes really do exist, where did Mersini-Houton and Pfeiffer, now notice here it has an F in it, but whatever, go wrong? One culprit is negative energy. There's more, this is one of the more confusing aspects of Hawking radiation. When the negative Hawking radiation goes inside the black hole, it causes the black hole to lose mass. But that phrase isn't as straightforward as it sounds. For one thing, the phrase negative energy is fairly ambiguous in the first place. Well, yeah. I do not find the proposal by Laura Mersini-Houton and Harold P. Pfeiffer credible. Andrew Hamilton of the University of Colorado, told ours in a response that later became a blog post. Again, peer-reviewed literature. They model Hawking radiation inside the horizon as a relativistic fluid with negative energy, which is gravitationally repulsive, and therefore causes the center of the black hole to bounce rather than collapsing to a singularity. Actually, that's not precisely what she said. She says the outside bounces rather than the center. But, however, this model is incorrect. If the negative Hawking radiation inside the black hole isn't like a fluid that puts a gravitationally repulsive force on the black hole as Mersini-Houton presents it, then what is it? Hawking radiation has negative energy inside the event horizon because its gravitational binding energy exceeds its rest mass energy, explained Hamilton. Wait a minute. He's just admitting that it's negative energy, isn't he? But apparently if you're inside, it doesn't look like negative energy. This is something that happens inside black hole horizons. Trajectories of particles can be so bound by gravity that it would take more than the rest mass energy to transport the particle to infinity. But any real observer inside the horizon would see the Hawking radiation as having positive energy, contrary to the author's simplistic assumption. Is there any real observer inside of the black hole? Well, certainly not people observers, because as you cross that threshold, you should be torn limb from limb, or probably before you ever get there. And that would go for the computer robots that we might send in to observe as well. And of course, they could never get out. But somehow, this is a really impressive argument, and so he says, ouch. You'll say ouch again later on. I'm going to skip over some of the stuff. You're certainly welcome to read and see if I've missed the most important arguments. But continue to some other comments he makes. Another issue is that Mersini-Houton's work required a specific model of something called a firewall. Well, that's the one that was created by Stephen Hawking, right? I hear that Hawking is at least a decent astrophysicist. Nobel Prize and all that stuff. A firewall is a wall of Hawking radiation particles that purportedly form? Okay. See, if it gets in your way, well, you can kind of throw these things at it, but if it doesn't, if it fits your theory, you just kind of encourage people to believe it. At the event horizon where it can prevent new matter from falling in. This contradicts a prediction of relativity, general relativity, where an observer should be able to pass through the event horizon without noticing that he passed through anything. Oh, really? So general relativity by itself without quantum mechanics is better than general relativity with quantum mechanics. Whatever. This is such a significant problem that it has become known as the firewall paradox. So once you put quantum mechanics to it, you're stuck with a firewall. And it has no resolution as of yet. Oh! You mean there's some doubt about this? Quite a bit of theoretical work has attempted to resolve the problem, including Mersini-Houton's. This is actually a legitimate way of looking at things. But physicists haven't reached a consensus on a solution yet. But they have reached a consensus that there are such things as black holes, right? And that one counts. I mean, after all, isn't science about consensus? Somehow I think Michael Crichton would disagree with that. Skipping over, of course, a historical precedent might not apply in this case. Well, it might not. But it does show that the universe doesn't always conform to our expectations, either intuitive or theoretical. Maybe cosmologists should be more in doubt. They're often wrong, but never in doubt. Is that right? Yeah. This is interesting theoretical work. Ooh. And it raises questions about the formation of stellar mass black holes, said Koberlein. Koberlein's a guy who is absolutely sure that they had to exist. To say that this work proves black holes don't exist is disingenuous at best. Well, I mean, if you use the term prove in the sense that you couldn't possibly be wrong, but it certainly does raise doubts, right? Maybe the tone should be lowered a little bit. It almost sounds religious. They're attacking our theory, and it just can't possibly be wrong. Now, my take on it, I think the theory espoused by Dr. Mersini-Houton is interesting. It would get rid of at least some singularities, maybe not all of them. Maybe it might encourage us to try to get rid of other singularities. Maybe the universe didn't start as a massive singularity. Interestingly enough, there's a proposal that the universe started as a white hole. That is the product of a creationist by the name of Russell Humphreys. Fascinating. And that allows, by the way, the universe to be 13 point whatever billion years old and the Earth to be 6,000 years old or 7,500 or whatever. The theory would be close to indistinguishable from standard black hole theories. It seems to be resisted on theoretical grounds as much as anything. It fits in with what I have been taught as standard stellar evolution. Now, I don't know whether this is really true or not, but this is the official story. The star, the size of the sun, will eventually run out of fuel. As it's starting to run out of fuel, it starts to expand into a red giant. And then when it loses its fuel, it'll start to collapse. And maybe once or twice it bounces a little bit, and then it will finally collapse into a white dwarf. And then gradually, as time goes on, white dwarfs lose their energy by radiation and they become red dwarfs, and not the official red dwarfs, but they will turn red and then they will turn cold and they will become quasi-black holes. Not really a full black hole. There's no singularity there. But they will be cold, and the only way you'll tell that they're there is by observing their pull on neighboring material. A star about 1.5 times the size of the sun or larger will collapse into something known as a neutron star, where everything is not only completely packed in, but that the electrons are squished into the protons. Now, a star about three sun masses is big enough that it should collapse into a full black hole. But interestingly, that's not what happens, at least in the standard telling of things. A star maybe 10 times the size of the sun will become something called a Cepheid variable, and it will pulsate every 3 days, every 10 days, every day and a half. The bigger they are, the faster they pulsate, and every time they expand, they throw off some gas. And then, when they get under that 3 limit, they pack down into a neutron star with waves of gas gradually spreading out. That's the story. A star much larger than 10 times the size of the sun will not just do the Cepheid variable. It will come back down on itself and then explode into something called a nova. leaving a black hole or perhaps a neutron star. At first, when I was taught about it, it was supposed to be probably a black hole. But now, supposedly on observational basis, it's really a neutron star that's left there. And it's less than 3 solar masses. Basically, the rest of the material is blown to infinity. Just a regular, this is a standard nova. Now, if you really have a big star, it explodes into a supernova. And those things can be as bright, and this is observational, as an entire galaxy. You will see a galaxy, and then 2 days later you'll get a photo of the same galaxy, and there will be a star there that will be as bright as the galaxy was. And then over time that fades out. And we've had stars like that in our galaxy, apparently. I think the Ring Nebula is one of them and was actually recorded at what particular date it exploded, or at least the light from its explosion got to Earth, because one day people looked up and they saw a new star. And so the bigger they are, the more they explode, but they don't turn into a black hole. And you see, if a black hole was that easy, everything's coming into it, and you form the black hole, and it just sucks everything down into it, right? But there's something that allows these huge stars, which should turn into black holes, rather than just going into nothing, they come down, and then they take off. If it were that easy to create a black hole, the star would not be expected to explode. It would just kind of get sucked into the middle. What's the explosion about? In addition, general relativity inside of a black hole would be expected to do some very strange things. And one of them is that it would seem like it would reverse time. At the surface of the black hole, time should stop. Then if you get more, you would expect the math to kind of reverse time. How do you do that? I'm not sure. And finally, it is not clear why light would not escape at the speed of light. And everybody is saying that, but what happens is that that you see it falling forever. It just, as it gets closer, it slows down. But light, as you may remember, this constant speed of light is the foundation of special relativity, which is the foundation of general relativity. So it should wink out. Now, the other thing that bothers me more than these kind of questions that I've had is that the opposition to the idea that black holes can't form sounds kind of religious almost. I'm going to give you a... This Brian Oberlein's comment, yes, Virginia, there are black holes. There's the last one right now is commented in 2016 in April. And he says, more importantly, gravitational radiation from two black holes has now been confirmed. So there is, how do you do that? I don't know. Gravitational radiation. So there's a brand new piece of evidence for their existence. You know, you think about it, how is that confirmed? A lot of black hole deniers, where have I heard that before? That sounds like climate change or evolution, doesn't it? Argued that gravitational radiation was non-existent and that LIGO was a waste of money. And now they got to eat their words. This sounds like somebody who's angry. Why should we be angry about this kind of questions? Does it really make that much difference? This sounds to me like somebody who can't stand to be wrong and is really upset that somebody is claiming that he's wrong. But anyway, now, I'm not saying that Mersini-Houton is right. Frankly, at this point, I don't have the knowledge of physics to be able to judge her math. Somebody else does. They claim that it's okay. Somebody else claims that it's not okay somehow. Nobody wants to go through and say, here, in this step, she assumed. But I do think that we have to be careful about believing that the scientific community has all the answers and that we should worship the current scientific consensus. I think we have to be careful about that. And I think that the reason for that is because we may be wrong on a lot of physical theories. We've been wrong in the past. There's no reason to believe that people from 100 years from now won't look at us and say, you know, they were really stupid. They just missed. And maybe Mersini-Houton is pointing out something that we should have picked up. And I think that evidence still matters. And theories that are built upon theories that are built upon theories that are built upon theories might somehow perhaps extrapolate a little too much. And that's the lesson, of course, I would take to various science-religion controversies, including creation-evolution, but that's my opinion. Now it's your turn.
Very interesting presentation, I think, and very good evaluation. And I sit and wonder about this. Why does cosmology claim such respect from the general public? As an example, it's sometimes stated that Stephen Hawking's books are the most popular unread books on the market.
Although, to be fair, I did actually read them.
And I think to a certain extent, and you pointed this out, and I wanted to emphasize this, mathematics engenders a lot of respect. It really works well, although you can negate its basis by several ways, but still it works very well. And these people have this mathematical capability that engenders a lot of respect. But it's the assumptions behind the mathematics that is overshadowed by the respect for the mathematics, and people don't look at the assumptions behind this. And I think this, to a certain extent, I remember when computers started becoming popular. And it was, hey, I calculated this on a computer. This was a class action activity to mention the word computer.
All of a sudden, you had to be correct.
Yes. And I think the same thing applies to mathematics here. And people being unfamiliar with the language of mathematics can't evaluate that very easily. And it kind of carries the day to a certain extent in such a deep pool of speculation here. But still people go for it and so on. But I think we need to distinguish, hey, behind all this mathematics, there are assumptions here or propositions and that are assumed that may be totally invalid, but don't get evaluated as it should be because people don't understand the mathematics.
Sounds to me as though mathematicians disagree quite a bit, so who understands it? Just seems to me like imagination is not physics and it's not mathematics.
That is true. Imagination is not physics. Mm-hmm. And the fact of the matter is that it's hard for our imaginations to go where the mathematics wants to push us. And I think we have to be willing to say sometimes, I don't know. And I think we have to be, when we have discussions, a little more evidence-based. And we have to be charitable to people who maybe don't see things our way, which, you know, some of this stuff, it sounds like you're attacking their religion. It really does. I mean, black holes are just that part of the universe now. We've kind of gotten used to them. We hate to lose an old friend. More than that, I almost think we hate to be wrong. And, you know, if you can do something like that with black holes, which, as far as I know, don't have any theological implications, maybe we need to be even more careful when you have propositions that are out there that do have theological implications. Comment here.
I have often wondered if this scientific information is true, what does it do to our worldview or universe view that God is in control of everything and it's peaceful and nice? We have exploding supernovas, we have galaxies crashing into other galaxies, we have what looks like chaos to me. What do we do with that?
Well, as long as no animals were hurt in the production of this film, we're okay.
Sometimes it's stated that creation is not science because there is no way to test it. There's no way to test an event like God creating in 6 days and so on. And to a certain extent, you can feel a little uncomfortable with that. There's certainly details that we don't know there. This thing, I would say, talk about not being able to test things and theories floating around. I mean, this is a prime example. Is it science? Well, scientists have the right to speculate and draw conclusions. But I would argue that the evidence for design is rather overwhelming compared to the evidence that you presented here for or against black holes. I mean, here's an area that speculation is rampant, but you get in the area of design. I mean, there's some pretty hard things to argue against the fact that there isn't design. But it's interesting that there's such interest in such ideas that we don't speculate, but we're not willing to mention the possibility of a creator in the equation.
Yeah, I agree. I think the evidence for design is far better than the evidence for black holes. And yet people hang on to black holes vigorously, and they will not hang on to design. And the contrast between the two is just phenomenal. We have a comment here and then one up there. Yes.
Just in reference to the gentleman's comment back there, how we should kind of view God in the midst of all this, we should view God still as loving and kind, the fact that we are here today. When you think about all the scientific laws and things like that, I still think it's still a miracle that our planet is alive and still functioning as it is, because sin has affected everything. And we know how sin has affected our lives here between people, animals, and just nature itself. I can't even imagine all the different complications outside our Earth that the universe itself has faced because of sin. And because of all the chaos and things that some scientists are trying to look at now, I think it's just a miracle and a God of love that's even protecting our planet from Satan. Because if it was him, if Satan was still in charge, this Earth would have been destroyed a long time ago.
I hope I'm quoting Mark Twain correctly. Maybe you can help me. I believe he said, the greatest danger is not from things which we're not sure of, but rather from things which we're very sure of, which just ain't so.
Comment has made the rounds quite a bit, and I think most people would agree with it.
This is slightly down a different bird walk, but not completely. I have discovered that I'm not a prophet. A year and a half ago, when my students in Canada said to me, oh, guess what? It's so funny. They came in from a break and they said, Donald Trump has put his name in to run for president. I said, oh, don't worry about it. He won't go anywhere. And all...
You were not alone, by the way.
I know. But over the last year and a half, we've been hearing these things, and the message from him has been fairly consistent, whatever that message was. But this last week, being a retired person, I have had time to watch the Senate debates, or I should call them the Senate attacks, of the various people that he has nominated for various positions. The one that I was most interested in was the one with Betsy DeVos for Education Secretary. And I didn't know anything about her, excuse me. Which at this point I really should have known something about her when I hear about her background.
Yeah. She's married to one of the Amway people, if I
yeah.
remember correctly.
They're yeah. extremely wealthy. They're like the second wealthiest family in the country, and I know nothing about them. But one of the things that came up, well, two things came up this last week that were of interest to me. Donald Trump himself said that he went to the funeral of Phyllis Schlafly, who died about 6 months ago. And she's one of the people that I studied when I was doing my dissertation in the early 90s as I studied the religious right, a very interesting person. And the second thing was they brought up in this hearing, somebody was just vicious angry at Betsy DeVos and just attacking her because of her belief in junk science. You believe in intelligent design, and you believe in, you know, various things, and they just viciously attacked her. And I thought, this is going to be a very interesting process of confirmation of the various people that Trump has proposed, because they seem to be almost uniformly conservative in one way or another. But that particular attack, I thought, is going to come out, going to be something we need to keep an eye on.
Yeah, well, it sounds like you may be there. It sounds like DeVos may be felt as a threat to their religion, so.
Oh, no question about it, because she's very pro-choice of schools. Watching her sit there, though, and take all of this with a smile on her face and come up with these very excellent answers, it was amazing. I thought, why would anybody put themselves through that? Why doesn't she just get up and walk out and say, keep it? But she didn't. She sat there and took it, as did other people. But the whole educational process over the last 25 years has been the powerful liberal left against the less powerful conservative right. And I don't like the term left and right, because I think it kind of separates us and it demeans the views of either side. But there are
people in the middle too
who
get ignored at that point. Yes.
Exactly. But I think with it we're in for a battle over a public education.
Well, I suspect that what some people call the far left is is losing and really does not like it. It'll be interesting to see what happens. I'm going to close this with a little artwork criticism since we're having a little fun. You will notice that there's a black hole, that there's an accretion disk, that there's these streamers that are coming out. The streamers are supposed to come out at the speed of light, or near the speed of light. Now, what accelerates them when they get coming in, presumably from the accretion disk, because there's no place else to get the, I don't think, to get that material, and sends it out as particles, I mean, not just photons, but actual, you know, electrons, protons, whatever, in this direction at the speed of light. This is, you can photograph some things that are supposed to be black holes, and you get that kind of picture. But it's not clear why it should stream in that direction. You'd think it just kind of spray in all directions, right? But apparently it comes into the black hole and does a 90-degree turn and takes off. The other thing that's interesting is that the star is here. There's a big star over here. Now, remember, this black hole originated from a star which was presumably bigger than the star on the right. Okay? Which meant that they must have touched. Which raises the question, why are they still separate stars? Beyond that, this black hole should be pulling in the star, giving a huge gravitational pull to it, and presumably making that star oblate shaped, although as I look at the star, it looks pretty spherical to me. And it's only pulling out bits of the atmosphere rather than sucking out chunks of the whole star, which is just fascinating to me, how they drew that.
You'd
like to have this. You'd like to have the star off a little ways so that it has. Now, one of the things that would happen with a binary system like this, if the larger one starts to get large, eventually it turns into a red giant, and remember, the sun turning into a red giant would swallow the Earth. It wouldn't necessarily stop it, although you'd think it slowly spiral, the Earth would spiral into the center of the sun as it lost momentum keeping going through sun material. It's very thin, but it's you know, thick enough that it would have some impact on the Earth, as well as Venus and Mercury. So when this star swells to a red giant, why would they not have fused then? There's just all kinds of interesting questions that are raised when you see that picture beyond what you would normally assume. Oh, they've got it right. I mean, after all, it's NASA. You know, they've got artists that can show everything just the right way. So I guess one of the other takeaway messages would be, don't believe everything you see. You know, that's... Anyway, next week we're going to talk about the earliest writing was Hebrew. Well, actually, the earliest alphabetic writing was Hebrew. So I think at least some of you will find that fascinating.